And before we actually start taking questions, I'm just going to pass over to the panel so that they can introduce themselves.
Good evening, everyone. My name is John Goddard. I'm the Supervising Solicitor for the Residential Advisory Service, or RAS. RAS was set up in May of 2013. We offer free legal and technical advice. The legal advice is offered through Community Law Canterbury, and the technical advice is offered by our technical panel, which is coordinated by MB. And so far, more than 10,000 people have called our contact centre, and we've opened more than 2,700 cases. We're available, we're a free service, and we're here to help people who have issues with their earthquake claims.
Hello, I'm Nairi Lambie. I'm from the Canterbury Earthquake Temporary Assistance. We have three arms to our service. One is financial, whereby once the insurance, if you've got to move out of your house and your accommodation insurance runs out, the government has a financial package you may be entitled to. The next is temporary accommodation, looking for temporary accommodation assistance for you. We have a variety of private landlords, plus also the villages, Rafiti, Linwood and Rangers Park, that you may be able to go to. And the third arm of the service is earthquake support, whereby you can have a support coordinator to help and assist you through the various issues you may arise, and they'll be with you with anything with EQC, Fletcher's, insurance, there to support you. This is also a free service, and I've got these pamphlets here if you want to look at them afterwards.
Great, thanks very much. So Tanya's going to grab the microphone and she's going to just start at the back row, so you can just signal to her if you have a question.
Oh, you do. Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you, Helen, for the introduction there. Rick Tindall, Spraydon Heathcote Community Board. You've indicated the implications for council infrastructure of sea level rise and coastal inundation, increased risk. What do we know specifically about the Bromley sewage treatment plants and how they're affected and what the remediation might be?
Okay, so if you look at the maps over the other side, you'll see that the Bromley treatment plant is actually relatively high, on relatively high ground, and well back from any of the coastal erosion areas. So I would expect the impact to be really just looking at whether or not any extra protection is needed on the oxidation ponds, on the estuary side of those, and also looking at where the outfall is, so the ocean outfall, and whether there's any erosion risk there.
Yes, go ahead.
See if I can word this right. But as I understand it, the current floor levels in the flood level control areas are set on the 1 in 50 or 1 in 200 year floods presently, whereas this is the 1 in 50 or the 1 in 100 year event in 50 or 100 years time. So how is one going to, I'm wondering like how the floor levels are going to be set presently. Are they going to be set based on those future dates and the flood extent's been modified?
Yes, so most of the properties in urban Christchurch will continue to be set, if you need a resource consent, by the floor level and fill management area on the 1 in 200 flood. And as I noted, 95% of our coastal inundation areas fall within that 1 in 200 mapping. So they'll continue to be modelled on that. If it's building consent, then they'll be set at the 1 in 50 level, but it'll be the higher of the 1 in 50 levels, if you like. So the rainfall and river contribution to the 1 in 50, and then there's the coastal inundation one, which will start to dominate out by the coast.
So does currently the mapping, the model for the flood levels, is that based on the rivers and the rainfall as opposed to the...
It's based on the rivers and the rainfall and how it might be held up by the tide. So it doesn't have that the storm surge built into it to quite the same extent.
Would that be updated to reflect that, or is it still, what I say, as a separate model?
It will be updated, but it'll make very little difference, actually. So that 1 in 200 level will be the highest level for almost all of those properties.
Yeah. Thank you.
Wow, that's a quick session today. So thank you very much, guys, for coming. I would encourage that if you do want to speak in any more detail that... we do have one more question. Yeah, go for it, please. We've got time.
Since there's time, I've got two.
There is time. Please,
right. Thank you.
Go ahead.
So it's not exactly clear whether there's any staged retreat from flood risk areas if potentially the estimates turn out to be conservative and that something's got to be done in terms of getting housing out of risk areas. Is any consideration being done to that? Or
the issue of staged retreat or managed retreat, it has been raised a number of times, and it is noted if you look in the urban development strategy documents from 2010, for example, the possibility of having to have some managed retreat from some of those areas. So that's a conversation that we need to have in the context of developing our natural hazards strategy. And it's a difficult thing to predict, as I said, because while the models can predict coastal erosion as an event that occurs over a certain time, we could get a large number of storms in a short period that impact on one particular part of the coast that could cause problems. And they have around the country. So this is also a national conversation, and we are looking for central government to update their guidance on sea level rise and how the whole country responds.
Thank you. Just one more, if I may.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, are you able to tell us anything in terms of how Christchurch City has adjusted to the earthquake experience and now this planning around sea level rise? In terms of civil defence, are there any extension of that kind of program, development of it, or updating? Is there anything new in that area?
We've got lots of experience, that's for sure. So I think probably the Christchurch City Council personnel are the most experienced civil defence response and recovery teams around the country. So there has been quite a focus on it, as you would imagine, and I'm part of the recovery part of civil defence. I don't think I'm tall enough to carry anyone out of a flood, so you know, put me at the other end of this. And also the community has responded a lot. So I think the community groups that are being encouraged through the civil defence networks for readiness and response have matured a lot in Christchurch. So there's been some good things there. Also, our city is becoming more resilient. So through the rebuild, where there's been an opportunity to build resilience in, that has often been taken, not always, because we haven't got enough money to always build in that level of resilience. But where there's an opportunity, that opportunity has been taken.
Yes, sure. We'll just grab the microphone for you.
Yes. Have you considered insisting that rebuilding in areas that are flood-prone should be relocatable?
That is one possibility. So with the new district plan rules, what is proposed is in these high-hazard coastal erosion, coastal inundation areas, a new subdivision new builds would be a non-complying activity. So that is, we wouldn't expect to issue a resource consent for new subdivision and new builds in these high hazard areas. And they would only get a consent if they've properly addressed the hazard, and that may be through the type of construction, or it may be through putting in something that's relocatable so that they can retreat out of it. So yes, relocatables are one possibility.
Following on from that, which way around is it? I live in South Shore, and I've seen lots of houses being rebuilt, and some of them are raised a metre, which is all very well, but it seems rather like putting one's thumb in the dike. But there's no, I don't see any relocatable houses going in. They're all very, very traditional, but raised.
Yes, so the rebuilds that are going on in South Shore at the moment are being done under the operative district plan. So these rules are proposed, and the policy and objectives provisions that go with them for coastal hazards will be notified 25th of July, and then there'll be an opportunity for the community to make submissions on those and have some conversations about not only what do we do in the district plan, which sort of sets the planning rules for the next 10 years, but what do we do long term, as indicated by, you know, the questions around strategic retreat. So how do we adapt over the next 50 and 100 years to this? And having a flexible pathway to that adaptation is really important, because the modelling and the predictions will continue to be improved over time.